Welcome to Speechless. Hey, we are not live tonight. Usually we are. So if you're watching this, this is pre-recorded, a special edition. I have too many events to tape, and what I am doing tonight, it's not tonight. This is going to be show, even though the date says September 24th, which is when we're filming. This will be shown October 1st. So that's the day you're watching this, not September 24th. But the deal is here, on September 24th, we're not live because I went and filmed another event, and Maplewood is putting on a policing in the 20th century type of event. But part of the presentation was about domestic violence against men. And so I wanted to film that, something that's been a big issue of mine, something I've been talked about on this show quite a bit and have had guests talk about. So I'm filming. So we're not doing a live show on the 24th. So we're doing this before the live show to play on October 1st. And on the 24th, some other show is showing that I did in the past. But something at this event on domestic violence, which a presentation will be made by the Tubman Institute on domestic violence against men. I'm going to come down there with my reports from Linda Kelly, a professor of law at the Florida State University. She wrote a law review article saying that men get abused just as violently and just as often as men, as women. And then there's a reference here, resource by Martin Fiebert from the Department of Psychology, California State University, and he has put together a catalog or an abstract. Well, it's a bibliography. You know, when this first came out, there was less than 200 studies, but now they got 343 scholarly investigations, 270 empirical studies, and 73 reviews and/or analyses, which demonstrate that women are as physically aggressive or more aggressive than men in their relationships with their spouses or male partners. So this whole domestic violence industry thing is just backwards. Well, I can't say it's backwards. Men do abuse women, but what's being ignored in the equation that women do abuse men. Therefore, the problem of domestic violence will not be solved unless everything's being dealt with. So I'm going to be down there. I'm going to be presenting this information when they have public comment. And I'm not afraid to do public comment, as you well know. That's why it's not a live show tonight, because I have to go film that event. This came out in the news. The North St. Paul, Maplewood, Oakdale Independent School District 622 just had their Moody's Investor Service, they downgraded them from, double A3 or big A, low A3 to A1. And so I'll give you more of that information in the future as to why this took place, but it has to deal with their debt load. They have prolonged operating deficits that result in further erosion of reserves and increased debt burden as the reasons for the downgrade. And that's pretty serious, and it's one of the reasons I think that the superintendent resigned and we got a new one now. So you can't blame that on the new one, school superintendent. However, what's been the philosophy of the superintendent that created this to happen? So there's going to be a levy asked for in the school district, but where's the accountability for the mismanagement of the funds? That's the big issue. A couple other things. I'm pretty big on cameras in the courtroom, and Michelle, I want to have you save this date. November 17th, she'll be in the appellate courts. Dealing with her right to have camera in the courtroom, which she was not allowed to have. U.S. Constitution says there's a freedom of the press, and it also says there's a person has a right to a fair trial. The courts have deemed in the past that a camera in the courtroom may not give a fair trial. My conclusion is cameras in the courtroom guarantees a fair trial, because the purpose of having the free press was to hold the government accountable. It wasn't to protect the defendant in this case, it was to protect the defendant against bad judges and bad government doing bad things. And so I asked to film that event. It was denied by the judge and the prosecutor. Michelle McDonald wanted it to happen, and so she is now saying in this appeal that she did not get a fair trial because it wasn't open to the public as much as it could been. And so the press filtered what took place in the courtroom. If you take a picture, you take that video, it's unfiltered, you get to decide. Now you got to listen to me tell you what I thought about it. Well, how do you know I'm telling you what's true? You know, I think I am, but you know, you may think differently. So why aren't we able to watch what actually took place so we can make up our own mind as to what took place? And here's another issue that came up regarding cameras. It's not regarding cameras, but this is federal courts. They don't let cameras in the courtroom at all in federal courts along any of the pathway, whether it's appellate court or not. At least Minnesota allows cameras for the appellate court. And I will film the Michelle McDonald court case on November 17th so that you can see the discussion, in my opinion, how the courts are going to take away your right to see a trial. But this happened in federal court, where a federal district court judge really pounded on an attorney who was asking permission to bring a motion to reconsider this judge's denial of a previous motion to dismiss. Okay, that was complicated, I understand. But here's the deal. And you're going to understand, it would have been nice to have seen this conversation, but this was all in letters, so we have it written down. The judge is saying here, this is Patrick Schlitz, and I think he's out of the Hennepin, Minneapolis courtroom, federal courtrooms. I am sorry, but I have difficulty believing that your failure to file a memorandum of law or meet and confer statement and your failure to email a proposed order to my chambers were all simply oversights. According to my courtroom deputy, when you called to get a hearing date, you were combative and rude, and you told her that she did not know what she was talking about when she informed you that the local rules require that your motion and supporting documents be filed simultaneously. Under the circumstances, I think it more likely that your violation of the local rules was the result of the same ignorance of those rules that you displayed in speaking to my courtroom deputy. For that reason, your request to bring a motion to reconsider is denied. According to the judge, this person wasn't following the rules. When he was explaining the rules, this attorney, Paul Gottfried, got a little upset. Of course, those are the allegations. We don't know. We didn't hear the conversation or anything like that. But either way, the judge is saying this is bad behavior on his part. So somebody heard about this and filed a complaint to the Professional Lawyers Responsibility Board and said that and gave him this letter and quoted the rules that the Office of Lawyers Professional Responsibility Board says if an attorney is rude, uses harsh language, or exhibits bad manners, such conduct would fall short of the profession's best standards. However, such conduct ordinarily would not violate a rule or of professional conduct. I'm sorry, that was a letter by an individual sent to Judge Schlitz. And so the point here is that the rules say different. You can't behave that way. And the Professional Responsibility Lawyers Board came back saying this discipline isn't warranted for this attorney because it's a civil matter in the context of which the above letter was written, and it's presently before Judge Schlitz. From the complaint, this isn't written well. From the complaint, it does not appear that Mr. Gottfried was sanctioned or that the court or opposing counsel referred the matter to the director. The court generally is in a better position, at least in the first instance, to determine whether a lawyer complied with the court's own rules and impact of any violation. Now, this is my answer to that is, so what? You know, just because a judge doesn't file a complaint against an attorney, which they're not likely to do, doesn't mean you can't, or you can't file a complaint against the judge. And the Board of Professional Lawyers' responsibility is not to take either issue, they're not to determine, oh, because he's a judge, that has a higher weighting, or because he's an attorney, that has a higher weighting than a citizen. However, in this case, that's looks like what's happening there. So I'll follow up more on that issue in the future. Hey, today on our show, and why I consider it a special show and wanted to get this one in as soon as possible, is there has been a lot of excitement in the 2nd Congressional District, to say the least. Representative Klein, U.S. Representative Klein, has decided not to run, which created an open seat in that area. And I have on as my guest David Gerson, who is running for that seat, who has ran before. And I just want to welcome you to the show. Glad to have you here.
Thank you. Great to be here.
Yeah. So why are you running? I mean, but you've ran before, haven't you, in this seat?
Yes. Yes. I'm running because I know that as a country we can do better. And we know that we need to return to local control. And there's no better way to do that than through a grassroots community organizing to support our values. And that's what we've been doing in CD2. And my campaign has been just part of that movement.
Well, you've ran, how many times before have you ran for this seat?
We started in 2012, and we went after the Republican Party endorsement in 2014, which John Klein won by just 3%.
Okay. So you hadn't run prior to 2014.
That was the first time going for the endorsement.
Wow. Right. So that's a pretty strong grassroots effort against a sitting U.S. representative.
Right, against a six-term representative who was a chair of the House Committee on Education and the Workforce.
Well, you call this a grassroots campaign. And so the implication there is that John Klein wasn't running a grassroots campaign. So how would you differentiate, why would you say that's different than what John was doing, Representative Klein?
I think the country understands that leadership in Washington hasn't been representing the people on both sides of the aisle. And the people of the 2nd Congressional District expected their representative to support our party's platform and to represent the people and our values and principles that make up that platform. We didn't feel that his voting record represented the platform and that his support of leadership, who wasn't maintaining the principles, also was an indication that he wasn't supporting us. And it was our role as the party to not only elect the endorsed candidate, but then to hold them accountable once they get to office.
And so this is a form of holding somebody accountable. Why don't you now give a kind of a history? Who is David Gerson? You know, what are you about?
Right.
What's your background?
I'm a private sector guy. I've got a couple degrees in engineering. I have a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering and a master's degree in industrial. I've always worked for big multinational corporations like IBM and Corning. I ended up going up a leadership ladder where I ended up in operations and doing transformation and change management. And I think that's what got me engaged in trying to get involved and make a change in our country and helping to reform Washington and we know that we can be doing so much better. We know that our principles matter, and we know we need to return to local control, and we know that we need to get principled people to D.C.
Well, I like your talk in that you're an engineer. I did not know that, but I have high respect for engineers. The main reason is if something isn't working, they know it's their fault, and they need to fix it. And they're the ones left to fix it, and they get it fixed, if it can be fixed, you know. So I like that mentality already, to say the least. And you probably see that there's a lot to be fixed in Washington.
Absolutely. This isn't going to change overnight, but I'm very optimistic. There's things happening in D.C. that we just couldn't imagine a year ago. We know Washington is broken, that it's working for the special interests. It isn't working for us. But what we're seeing is, for the first time, 24 people voted against Speaker Boehner to be Speaker in the first vote of the House. We had a Ted Cruz that stood up on the Senate floor and called out Mitch McConnell for lying to his Republicans. We've had Mark Meadows put forward a resolution to vacate the chair because Boehner was not following our principles and upholding the powers of the House of Representatives. And I think that the presidential campaign is an indication that the people want to see change. They expect true representation to the principles that the parties claim that they represent, and not just empty campaign promises. And that's why I think you're seeing people engage in the process that had never been engaged before.
So these people, and you call it grassroots, why does it seem to be stronger in the second congressional district than other places?
I think we just created that critical mass down there. There was a group of local leaders that shared these principles that just felt the responsibility to engage when it was difficult, mm-hmm. when it maybe even wasn't safe to take on your sitting incumbent. Someone that believed in the Republican Party principles and felt that if we held our incumbents accountable, we would actually be winning in almost every race, because we know the people share our values, but they understand that our representatives, and especially leadership, isn't upholding their principles. So it's not worth potentially supporting a Republican candidate because it doesn't mean something. And I think these people felt a civic responsibility to be engaged and work from the inside and make a difference and try to make some change and take a responsibility to not just lob grenades over at the party, but become the party and make a difference and show what could be done.
Well, with that grassroots movement, do you think that you're going to be the Republican-endorsed candidate for 2016?
We absolutely believe that we are going to be the endorsed candidate in 2016.
And why? Why do you think that's going to take place? What, you know, gives you that confidence?
Well, it's just relationships. People know me. They understand that I've been working with these leaders within the community that have taken responsibility to work within the party and make a difference. And they've seen me working to grow the party, to reestablish our integrity in upholding our principles. And they've seen me and have gained trust in me to do what I say and take the difficult stands when there's something on the line, and be willing to take on the difficult issues. And they saw me willing to take on a fight while the powerful chairman was still in office. I was willing to run, and I was willing to continue to talk about what is the proper role of the party and what is the proper role, you know, for us as activists.
I noticed that, you know, once, because I've been following your campaign and various things, a lot of campaigns anyway. But once that seat became open, first of all, I thought you had a real good chance of winning, even if Klein ran again. I felt that was there. But when he stepped down, I was surprised that all the names that got thrown out there, like Mary Plenty, Mike McFadden, Steve Drazkowski, that they just very quickly pushed it aside. I mean, that's pretty telling to me, because that's a seat that pretty much, in my opinion, whoever gets that Republican endorsement is going to win that seat. So it seems to me to be an easier race than, say, running in the 4th congressional district, you know, where the math just isn't there. So why do you think that is? I mean, I have my opinions. I'll share those with you. But why do you think some of these big names didn't jump in?
Well, I think it's recognized that we are the grassroots and that I have the support of the party in the 2nd congressional district. And that's why a group like Madison Project out of Washington, D.C. has endorsed me. Madison Project has only endorsed 8 congressional candidates, one of them being Senator Mike Lee. And it's because they believe that the grassroots engaging is what's going to turn this country around. The grassroots getting involved in the political process, inspiring local leaders that they can support to run, get them to Washington, D.C., who are going to maintain their principles, and that's what's going to turn this country around. And Madison Project was aware of it. I think that it's recognition by people that I am going to get the endorsement. And what I respect about the influence that it has is that people should respect the party's endorsement. It's a very important principle that we follow, that we know that the activists that get involved at the grassroots level that go through the vetting process for the endorsement, they commit a lot more time and their resources actually determining what the principles of the candidates are, who will best represent them. Mm-hmm. And they are able to, with a much finer tooth comb, vet the candidate and ensure that they are the right person to represent that community. And to skip that process, I think will really destroy something special we have here in Minnesota.
Well, it does. And if your candidate, if you're part of the grassroots and your candidate doesn't get endorsed, I see what happens a lot is people tend to walk away and get discouraged. Instead of looking at it and saying, hey, this candidate now knows me. Yeah, they know I wasn't for them. But I'm not against them either in everything. They're my representative. I think the attitude should be, I have an ear with them, and so now I should support them and hold them accountable. And so I think people lose that aspect of the endorsement process and the candidacy process. And so when you didn't get endorsed, you supported Klein.
That's right. I conceded the endorsement. I was asked whether I would like for them to read the results that would say that I only lost by 3%, or if I'd like to concede. And I went up to the podium and said, I respect the voice of the body. The body has chosen Congressman Klein. Now we all need to get behind Congressman Klein and make sure he beats the Democrat.
Well, and in that process, from my observation, there was pressure put on him to consider other legislative options. You know, not that he did in everything, but he did move more towards your thinking, didn't he? I mean, that's my opinion. He's not totally there on some huge issues, definitely. But he's not running now, so it's you. One of the big issues, though, is that you've made a pledge not to support John Boehner.
Absolutely.
For Speaker of the House. And that is something Klein did do, is he did support John Boehner. And you're also challenging the people who are running for the endorsement to do the same.
Absolutely.
Why? What's your concerns about John Boehner, and why aren't you supporting him as Speaker?
Well, John Boehner is seen as the party. You know, when we talk about leadership not upholding the party, you know, we're talking about John Boehner and Mitch McConnell. They have such an impact as to whether the Republicans are seen as principled actors that are representing the people or that they're selling out to special interests. And we've seen time and time again where the people haven't been represented, where our principals haven't been representative, where there's been compromise that's been unacceptable, where they've abdicated responsibility to the executive branch and not followed through with their responsibilities in Congress. And I hope to talk about that more. But I think what our movement has been about and what my campaign has been about is that we can't go along to get along in D.C. And why I think that I've received the support is I was willing to stand up to leadership here within the race and stand up to an incumbent, you know, based on them not upholding our principles.
The Republican principles. Yeah.
That's right. And so that's what people want to see. They want to see that I'm not going to Congress just to fight leadership. I'm going there to make change. But they know that if it's necessary, I'll take on leadership even with in my own party.
Well, obviously you're willing to do that, and to have some pretty heavy hitters decide not to run, I think says a lot for you and the campaign that you already have going there. Mitch McConnell, who touts himself as a very pro-life candidate, but won't bring a vote. Now, he's the Senate. You're running for House. I realize it's a different branch, but the same type of thing happens in the House. And this is the example I'm thinking of now.
Sure.
Said, I'm just not going to bring an abortion issue to the Senate vote and try to get a law passed and use whatever means I can use to get a restriction on abortion through. I think that's a mistake. What's kind of your opinion on that whole process?
It's absolutely unacceptable. The best mechanism that they have is to add a defunding clause to the continuing resolution, send it to the president, and say, if you're not willing to sign it, let's have a discussion here in America about why you're not willing to sign it.
I think that sends a message, that defunding, it just sends a huge message to people out there, and it puts the pressure on Obama. There's one person that then ends up being accountable for all these babies' deaths. You know, it's not only their deaths, but it's also forcing people to pay for something that is diametrically against their faith, their religious beliefs, and you're forcing people to pay for these abortions. So
what I would say is, you know, we got control of the House and people expected change. We being the Republicans, then took control of the Senate. But the Republicans in the House said, hey, well, okay, we have the House, but we don't have the Senate. You get us the Senate, we'll give you some change. So we got the Senate. What's happening? We don't see any change. We see compromise. So now what excuses are you hearing? Well, we don't have a filibuster-proof majority in the Senate, so we can't do anything. Or we don't have the presidency, and Obama's always going to veto whatever we send up there. And it's an unacceptable excuse, and people aren't buying it anymore. And I have optimism because there are some principled people, especially, well, in both in the House and the Senate. I'll talk more about the House because that's where I'm going.
Sure.
There's a House Freedom Caucus that's being run by Jim Jordan with principled people, with organizations that are out in Washington, D.C. to support them, and grassroots communities across the country that are supporting them, that are making a difference, and that are starting to organize and build their numbers. And you see them standing together on this Boehner resolution, and you see them pulling together on strategy. And people are now starting to believe that they can send a representative to Congress that will maintain their principles. And they'll no longer buy the argument that a representative has to compromise or they're going to lose the next election to a Democrat.
So why do you think it's important that President Obama is forced to veto something? Why? I mean, McConnell and some of the Republicans are saying, okay, yeah, like you said, he's going to veto it. My concern is, so what? Let him. You know, why not put the pressure on him? It's on him then. He's the one that's going to be shutting down Congress, not Congress, or shutting down the budget or the state.
James Madison said that the House of Representatives greatest power is the power of the purse.
Mm-hmm.
And Boehner is abdicating that responsibility to the executive branch. And they should be line by line going through the budget and appropriating and ensuring that constitutional and necessary programs are being funded. And they should do the same thing with Planned Parenthood and defunding it. And it's Congress's job to provide that budget, that appropriation, to the executive branch. And if the executive branch finds that there's something unacceptable about it, then they need to have that conversation with the American people as to why whatever Congress delivered to them, which is their mm-hmm. responsibility, wasn't appropriate.
Very good. Checks and balances is what you're talking about, which seems to be very much lacking. The phrase that gets used a lot, separation of powers.
Right.
And I'm going, yeah, okay, separation of power, very real issue, but there's also checks and balances. And President Obama, he's using his checks and balances to an extreme, which is saying, yeah, Congress, you said that, but I'm the president, I can do whatever I want.
My biggest concern is that Congress has been willingly abdicating their responsibility
right.
to the executive branch. As brilliant as our forefathers were, our founding fathers were so wise. And when you read the Federalist Papers and the Anti-Federalist Papers, they predicted almost everything that would happen here in America as government grew and we saw capitalism turn to crony capitalism and special interest groups start to run DC. With all their wisdom, they could never conceive of Congress willingly giving up their powers. We see that with this Iran deal. Congress should be treating this Iran deal as the treaty that it is. The Corker-Cardin bill was unacceptable. It is not an executive agreement. Congress should be ratifying that Iran deal as a treaty.
Exactly.
Congress is supposed to write the laws. They write these ambiguous laws and throw them over the wall to the executive branch, which allows these bureaucrats to write these regulations that are shackling our economy. That's really the equivalent of writing legislation with no congressional oversight. Only Congress can declare war. Again, abdicating to the executive branch. And what are we talking about now? We're talking about these budgetary responsibilities. The House has the power of the purse, yet they're allowing the executive branch and Obama to drive the agenda and to drive the budget.
You brought up Iran. We're going to talk about that in a bit, but this abdicating responsibility, I want to bring that up because it happens here at the state level too. That's just a huge concept that really needs to be dealt with, and I'm glad to hear you're going to do that. But I was down at the St. Paul School Board this last Tuesday. They cut out the filming of a visitor's presentation, but I read the Minnesota Constitution. And I saw the one section about public schools in there, and the purpose of public schools is to have a well-educated public in order to preserve the Republican form of government. That's their one job, preserve the Republican form of government through a well-educated people. And so I just said, what are you doing to achieve this end? Every grade level should have classes, and the major emphasis is to teach them to be smart enough to know that the Republican form of government is the best government. What are you doing to preserve that all the way through? And so that gets me to the whole issue of a national education, either federal or corporate education system. I mean, it's still one entity controlling all of education. Mm-hmm. Where kind of do you see this national education or corporate education movement that's going on?
I'm starting to see this as a bipartisan issue mm-hmm. where people recognize that we can't have bureaucrats in DC determining the best way to educate our children. That we have to move back to local control. We have to have our children's education be determined by Minnesota's parents and teachers. we have to eliminate No Child Left Behind. We have to eliminate Common Core. We have to remove federal control from education. We have to create incubators of innovation within the communities to meet the special needs and unique needs of each community. We have to get the federal government out of education.
What authority does the federal government have to be in education? I don't.
There is nothing in the Constitution and the enumerated rights that they have any constitutional authority to be involved in education.
You mentioned No Child Left Behind, which is kind of some of the current program, but that's a federal program that's being pushed. And Common Core, though, is not being pushed by the federal government. It's being pushed by the Bill Gates Foundation and by Pearson Publishing Companies, which they're teaming together to control it. So a corporate, which is new. And I think when organizations or governments get a kickback, get pushback from, oh, we don't like this because it's federal, well then, okay, let's not make it federal. Let's get a couple corporations to do it all. And it ends up being federal in the same sense.
You know, you bring up a great point. We always felt our children's education was sacred. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't to be a profit center for a corporation. Mm-hmm. Yet what you're alluding to is they're starting to form an education cartel.
Right.
In exactly. America. And they're starting to lobby on the Hill to their benefit and to the detriment of our children's education. And that needs to be exposed. Though Common Core was supposedly not developed by the federal government, through Race to the Top grants, Common Core was incentivized by the federal government, as well as states who said that they would adopt Common Core were allowed to be, I guess, not held to annual yearly progress testing that's part of No Child Left Behind, which got many states to commit to Common Core. So the federal government has actually been putting incentives out there which have had the states sign up to adopt the Common Core standards.
It's trickery and deception just right. All the way around and playing off people's basically lack of education that they didn't learn in Minnesota, the Republican form of government, so they can't figure out what's happening to them. It's a sad deal. This plays into the Republican presidential race. You're pushing for responsibility for the executive branch. How does that play into the Republican presidential candidacies?
Well, I hope we end up with a candidate that's going to return power to the people in the states and act in within the bounds of the Constitution and under mm-hmm. the rule of law. I think that's something that has become clearly evident to people, is that we're starting to see the president and Secretary of State mm-hmm. and perhaps the head of the IRS that are somehow above the rule of law, and we need to return to everyone being under the same rules and maintaining their constitutional authority. And what I would say about the presidential race that's exciting is this is the first time that I can remember where it wasn't a given that the status quo establishment Republican candidate would surely be the primary or the endorsed candidate. And I think that tells a lot about where people are and how frustrated they are with what they see as the political class.
Yeah, well, there's that's definitely there. And I see that also on the DFL side, in a sense, where the grass, I don't know how to exactly say this. I wouldn't call it grassroots, but there's definitely, you know, the reason Obama got in, the reason Bernie Sanders, is there's a wide part of our population that just wants things given to them. that are the socialists. And what one reason I like your campaign is because you're wakening people up that our liberties are at stake. There is a big threat to our liberties, and you've been able to engage the people of your community to wake up to that, that they won't be able to raise their kids in their religion and the upbringing that the parents want. They won't be able to, they'll end up, you know what, your job, you're gonna end up working for the state, you know, and rather than building your own community. So there's, it's just disturbing to me to see this outcry for socialism in a communist system in America. What are your concerns about that, that is taking place?
I hope, you know, I'm optimistic that we can turn things around, and there's so much opportunity given the overregulation and shackling of our economy to improve things that I'm optimistic. I think people have seen, as Obama has taken us more towards these programs and away from free markets and away from the principles of local control, that those programs aren't working. Mm-hmm. And I think Obamacare is an example of that, and especially when it's fully implemented, people are going to recognize that we have to go to free markets, consumer-based solutions for us to be competitive.
And so what I hear you saying there is that Obamacare is something you really want to deal with. You want to...
It has to be repealed.
What are your goals there?
It has to be repealed. We need to go to a consumer-based private sector solution.
And that, I see that as an essential thing that has to happen. Otherwise, we're messed up as a country. It's over. The changeover going back is because of what we've been put under now. The change going back, I can see being a little bit of a rough road. How would you propose to get that change back, get us back to where we need to be, and to solve some of this, the changes that are going to take place in the meantime?
Yeah, I would say that that's true for every federal program that exists. We could talk about how do we get out of No Child Left Behind and federal funding for education. We could talk about how do we get the federal government out of funding the transportation roads and bridges, which should really be controlled by the states. Mm-hmm. And with every program, we're going to have to, as an engineer, we're going to have to create a transition plan. Mm-hmm. And there's going to typically be some form of block granting back to the states and allowing them to then pick up the revenue sources to be able to provide the services that they decide within their own state as the federal government winds down. And I think that the further that we kick the can down the road and don't deal with whatever the issue is, whether it's entitlement reforms for these programs that are going to become insolvent, or whether it's just budget deficit issues or winding down the federal Department of Education's controls of our local schools or Obamacare, that the longer we wait to make these changes, even though there's going to be short-term pain, the more difficult it's going to be in the future.
Well, it seemed to me that those pushing Obamacare or the Affordable Care Act didn't seem to be concerned about who got thrown to the wayside. I don't think that's the Republicans' intent, is to throw people to the wayside, but it's not going to be necessarily a smooth transition back to a free market. But it's going to be a better transition than what we were presented with.
I think we understand that the free market principles, consumer decisions, meeting the needs of consumers, competition is what's going to create productivity in our economy and provide the opportunity for people to have better lives. And the more federal government top-down interference that there is, the more that having special interest access is going to gain benefit for those who can afford access. Mm-hmm. And it's going to end up hurting our society and hurting our economy, and it eliminates opportunity and is counterproductive. And we understand that Obviously, there's going to be some short-term pain in dealing with any of these solutions, but we understand that that's what's going to bring long-term prosperity. And we have to have people that are willing to engage in those difficult conversations and be willing to make those transitions.
Well, I've had some experience with hospitals, with family members, and I have a number of medical people in my family. And dealing with the whole concept of having a hospitalist, you have your doctor, they can't go into the hospital. They can't take care of you. You got to explain everything 5 times a day to the hospitalist, and that hospitalist changes. I don't see how the people are being served by this system. It's just outrageous. So I definitely support any way you can improve that system. And I only see, like you see, the only way to get that back on track is just get rid of Obamacare and let the free market take over.
Yeah, and I mean, I think we get hit as Republicans as that we don't care.
Yeah.
When we do care. The point is, we care enough about our children's education that we don't want a bureaucrat in D.C. providing a one-size-fits-none solution. Mm-hmm. We care enough that we know that we want our parents and teachers and local communities to decide what's best mm-hmm. for their children and how they're educated. And, you know, that's why we understand that as power grows at the federal level, we lose that kind of control, we lose that kind of input, we lose access to even have these discussions with those people in D.C. unless you're a powerful lobbying group. And now, unfortunately, we're seeing the end result. Mm-hmm.
So let's get back to the Iran deal. What do you think about this?
It's a terrible deal. I'm a Jewish American. Mm-hmm. I'm obviously concerned about the United States. I'm concerned about Israel. I'm concerned about increased funding to a state sponsor of terrorism. I'm concerned that we've negotiated away some influence we had without gaining any benefits. And I think it's a terrible deal. And I think that this Corker-Cardin bill, which has somewhat approved it being an executive agreement, is completely unconstitutional. And this is absolutely a treaty, and it should be ratified by the Senate.
I appreciate you saying that, because when I was looking at that and listening to the news and not really grasping everything going on, and I'm saying, okay, is this a treaty or not? I think it should be a treaty, and they're talking like it's a treaty. But all of a sudden, they're talking about the president being able to veto something. And I go, no, a treaty, the Senate has to confirm it. There's no veto issue here. It has to be approved by the Senate, ratified by the Senate, this treaty. So where are they getting around all this stuff? So you're saying there's a bill, a Cochran, which what was he thinking, bill that said, how did it come from being a treaty where the Senate approves it to be having to be a vote in the House and the Senate?
Right, yeah. It turns the Constitution on its head. This is absolutely a treaty. I think Congress, the leaders of Congress, were unwilling to fight to hold our president accountable to the Constitution. And again, we're willing to abdicate this responsibility away to the executive branch because they didn't want responsibility. And that's really what we're seeing, is they're giving away their powers because they didn't want to be held accountable for the deal. So basically, this Corker-Cardin bill said, well, we have a lawless president who's going to treat this Iran negotiation as an executive agreement, and we're not even going to have any say in it because he's going to call it an executive agreement. Let's pass a bill that says it's not an executive agreement that the president can do on his own, but we'll have the right to vote against it through this Corker-Cardin bill. Which basically then, even if they disapproved it with the Corker-Cardin bill, the president can veto it or the Senate can filibuster it. And what it does is it forces the Senate to come up with a two-thirds majority to disapprove it instead of the two-thirds majority to ratify the treaty. And again, it comes back to, why is it that Congress is abdicating their responsibility to the executive branch? Why aren't they standing up and saying, no, this is our power here in the Senate. We understand how important it is to have these divisions of power, as you were talking about, and the executive does not have the authority to do this.
Does that Corker-Cardin bill then apply to all other treaties?
It was specifically for this Iran deal.
Just for, I sure hope somebody challenges that right away in court, because President Obama is going to go with this thing, and it won't be overturned. Essentially, it can't be for all practical purposes. So it has to be done through the courts, and by the time it goes through the courts, it's too late.
Right now, it's very complicated. There's some aspects of the bill that Obama hasn't met. There's some secret agreements out there that haven't been presented to Congress, and he had 60 days to provide the entire bill to Congress for review. And so that's being challenged on some technicalities. But this, you know, we can get into the technical aspects of the bill and how they're trying to now fight it, but it never should have been passed to start with. There should have been this discussion of the constitutionality of it, that this is a treaty that needed to be ratified by the Senate, and that we can't allow our Congress to continue to abdicate their responsibility.
And that goes to the whole aspect of, do our legislators understand our Constitution, what their responsibilities are, and you can tell the ones that fully don't understand because, well, they got to figure out what Common Core is about first, you know, and,
right.
and they make a decision before they really know what it's about, and then they have to backtrack because they have pressure. Well, that just tells me you don't know what the Constitution is about, you know, and that's why I've always enjoyed listening to you and what you've had to say is you get it. You don't have to think about things. You understand the principles behind them and where they fit in with the Constitution, and will uphold that. That's my understanding of you. When you're in Congress, of course. Well, let's go back to this Planned Parenthood issue with all the press that's come out. How do you propose to defund Planned Parenthood?
There's only one way to ensure that it's defunded, and that is by attaching that clause to this continuing resolution.
Okay.
And forcing the president to have a conversation with America as to why he won't fund the government through the bill and the budget, which is the responsibility of the House to create, that came to him.
All right. And then one other issue, just kind of re-go over this. What do you think is the proper role for education?
At the federal level?
At the federal level.
We need to return to local control. And again, I'm starting to see this become a bipartisan issue. Parents, whether they're Democrats or Republicans, they don't want to see their kids subjected to Common Core standards. They understand the implications of No Child Left Behind and how it's increased administration costs and reduced flexibility in school systems. And they want to return to local control. And they're so frustrated that they can't go to D.C. and have this who do they talk to? It's hard enough to go to St. Paul and talk to your legislator. You know, they go to their local school board, and their school board has this influence from the federal government, and their administrators have this influence from the federal government, and they have them under the hook by being scared that they're going to lose their federal funding. And we have to eliminate that. We have to return controls of our children's education back to our parents and teachers.
And I see a lot of these school districts as really wanting the federal funding. You know, if you're looking at St. Paul, they don't care about the ties that their hands get tied with. It's just another reason to raise more taxes and put more money into the system. So that's part of the problem in inner city schools and stuff like that. Well, we just got a couple minutes left here. So what, let's just re-go over. Why are you running? Why should people vote for you?
Well, I'm running because we know America can do better. And we know we can have representative government. And we are demonstrating in our congressional district that the grassroots can get engaged and make a difference. You feel so powerless when you're sitting at home and you're seeing the problems that are out there. And how do you get involved? How can you, as an individual, make a difference? Is there an organization out there that's effective that you can engage with? are there even people involved in politics that you can trust? Mm-hmm. You know, I sit across the table from the people that I've built relationships with over the last 3 years, and it's so difficult. You know, they look into my eyes and they say, you know, you're willing to go to Congress and be a congressman. I can't trust you. You know, it doesn't matter whether I've been a career politician or not. Just the fact that you're willing to do it. Right. You know, we are so skeptical these days. Mm-hmm. And you don't hear about these principled representatives like Jim Jordan, Thomas Massey, Raul Labrador, Justin Amash. There's some fantastic Ted Yoho. There's some fantastic mm-hmm. legislators out there. Mark Meadows, you're just not hearing about these guys. You know, you're constantly barraged with the insider deals, the disappointments of leadership not standing up for our principles. And so our candidacy is a demonstration of what can be done when you organize in a local community. And that there's organizations in DC that are out there to support the grassroots and understand that we need to have this bottoms up control to get our country back on the right track.
All right. David Gerson, thanks for coming on the show. I really appreciate it, and best to you in your race for the U.S. representative.
Thank you so much.
It's a big deal. All right, let's go to, thank you. We're running out of time here very quickly, and just want to remind you that if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? Your best day to do that is March 1st. 2016, go to your precinct caucus. And if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week. Sure.